I know that this term is overused, and it bothers me to overuse something. When I say overused, I mean it has been used enough times where we might think that we understand what it means, and maybe we do understand somewhat. But don't you know that in everything of the Lord, there's always more and more and more and more? And if we, I've often said that good is the, you know, that better is the enemy of good. If we're doing good, we won't do better because we're doing good. You know, we don't think I'm doing good. I want to do better. We think, you know, thank God I'm doing good. I hope I don't slip back into doing bad. But there's so much more, and that the term I was talking about is how this revelation of this art, or you know, to get it on spiritual terms or terms that are eternal, there is the revelation of this vessel, this vehicle that we are saved in, and we're more than saved. We are made one with, and we are brought into the newness. Now that's important. I know we're all familiar with that term. We're brought into the newness. But I mean, how many of you feel like you're walking in newness, you know? I mean, it is not a doctrinal thought. Well, I'm in newness because I'm born again, even though my life's miserable. You know that? You're talking about finding something. You know, I want us to have something real. I don't care about this. Bible school in that sense. I really don't. You know, God used me to raise up new creation. God used me to raise up the Bible school, but only for one reason. That we might together know the Lord. That's my heart. That was what was in my heart originally. It's still in my heart. Call me old school. But that's it. And this oneness and this newness, to spring forth. I understand there's winter, and I understand there's fall. I'm not trying to change the times and the seasons of God. That's not what I'm talking about. I just want to make sure we come into the spring and the summer, that's all. And just to make sure that we get all of it. And, you know, that ever since I've saw Jesus once I was 21 years old, when I began to come to a revelation of Christ. I still haven't fully come to that revelation, but I'm still coming. But people have always said stuff like this to me. Randy, you preach the cross. You preach death. We need life. I preach the cross, and I preach life. It's not all about just dying in your physical circumstances. Being miserable. It's not about doing without. It's not about people mistreating you. It's about living by the victorious life of Christ in all things. And there is peace with that, and there is newness in that, or should be. There can be. How about that? There can be. Whether that be your experience or not, saying that it can be, and it should be. My goal as a pastor and my goal as the director of Bible school is that life be released, and that life be Christ. And by being Christ as our life, we are free from so much of the bondage and the hurts that are not changed. God doesn't, you know, God doesn't change everything around us. He changes us, and He changes us into that image. In that. So, you know, and to explain all that is ridiculous, because only the Holy Spirit. And that ought to be a valuable thing for you to say. You know what? I believe Him. I need to get after the Lord and find the Lord in this world. All right. So, when Noah is seeing this ark, he's seeing that God is really opening secret counsels. He's opening his eternal counsel never would have seen an arc. You've got to find, you got to find that arc in his heart, not just in his eyes. And so Noah saw that this arc was more than just a temporary deliverance, more than just a situational thing. This is the way God operates. This is the way God saves. This is consistently going to be it for all time. And this is, you know, this is where faith comes from. Noah was one of those in the hall of faith. You know, by faith so-and-so, by faith so-and-so, by faith, Noah saw the reality and went to work to build it in his own life. To be Jesus. I want it to be Jesus. And don't you know that I or you have, we can be open to the enemy just like Judas was. I don't want to be on the outs with the Lord. I want to be in tune with his heart, not just looking at how things are going and saying, Jesus, you're not doing a very good job with this. I mean, don't you think Judas kind of, you know, that's, I don't need to speculate, but I think he was kind of looking at things. Probably a better way of going about this. I think my mind has got a better grasp of this than the eternal Son of God. Let's see. Let's turn to 1 Peter. Not a lot of scriptures in the Bible about Noah. Did you know that? So because of that, we're only going to have like five classes. If you believe that, I've got a whole bunch of stock I want to show you. First Peter chapter 3, verse 20. But one time were disobedient when once the long suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was preparing, in which few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water, the like figure under which even baptism, doth also save us, after putting away the filth of the flesh, with the answer of a good conscience toward God, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this thing mentions waited in the, you know, once in the long suffering of God waited, and I was reminded recently, I had done a chart when I was in Bible school. I put Adam, drew a line for Adam, and then it said how many years he lived, so I drew it out to that many years. Of course, I had a thing for every 50 or 100 years back then, marked 100 years, you know, and so he was, what, alive during the time, during the lifetime of Lamech, who was the father of Noah. Adam was still alive during the lifetime of the father of Noah. And there was this other guy who lived for 969 years or something, the longest man who ever lived, his name was Methuselah. But I can't find where I found the thing. I looked it up somewhere a long time ago, and I've looked it up in Strong's, and it doesn't say that, but I looked it up in some book, and it said that the name Methuselah means when he dies, the end will come. And it might have been why I did that chart. Because almost 1,000 years earlier, this Methuselah guy was born, and when you put it down on a chart and you figure it out, the exact day Methuselah died is the day they entered into the ark. Yeah, you're just kind of going,
whoa, that's like one of those days in the 60s. Whoa.
Methuselah represents the long suffering of God. That when he was born, his daddy said, when this guy dies, that's going to be the end. And so God let him live as longer than anybody else, as long and long and long and long and long and long and long as he could. Just showing that long suffering of God. Just showing the incredibleness of, you know, I mean, because if God was just hacked off, you know, anybody ever notice that when you're hacked off, you do rash things quickly? So the judgment of Noah wasn't a rash thing done quickly. Methuselah proves it. Even Jesus, when it says that he went in, you know, that he made this scourge and he went into the temple and he drove out the money changers. Did you ever think about that? You know, get out of here, you know. Well, it says it didn't say he went and bought one or found one or somebody gave him one. It said he made a scourge. in that vehicle of God's mercy. Not just God is merciful. You understand what I'm saying? Not just God is merciful, but finding the vehicle of God's mercy. Christ. Not looking to yourself, not fainting over yourself, not freaking out over yourself, not if we are to consider you, there is much to despair over. Bring up stuff that they had done that they'd never admitted and all this stuff. And bring all this, and they called it life sessions. I would call it darkness sessions. You know, I was we alluded to this not that long ago, but I was thinking about it today while sitting on the toilet. Is this scripture that says that Israel, God commanded Israel, when you poop, you take it outside the camp and you bury it. Outside the camp and you bury it. You are buried with Christ. And you know, what most people want to do is they say, okay, now, you're going to get constipated with all the garbage in you and all the upset and all the unforgiveness. You're going to get all impacted until you explode. So you got to get it all out. Here's how you get it all out. You just bring it all out in the open. You just get a table and you lay all the poop out on the table and you examine it. And if you got a problem with somebody else in the room, you rub it in their face. That's not the pattern. The pattern is, yes, get it out. Don't let it impact you. Don't let it get it out. But don't rub it in people's face. Take it out of the camp and bury it and forget about it. I got about four amens there, but that's good enough. We just get four. There'll be less poop flying in this place. All right, I'm off of that. I know how disturbing that is. You think I'm weird. That's a scriptural thing. It's totally scriptural. God made that up. You think that? I can just tell you other stuff God made up that I didn't. I'm telling you, but we don't want to talk about that because we're holy and special. But all these things have spiritual meaning to our lives if we'll just understand what it is that God's trying to say and what it is. So, the destruction then is for those that are outside. Now, here's the deal. Did you ever think that, I thought this, so I'll be the first one to say it. What is wrong with God when the floodwaters start coming? Don't you know all the people for 120 years that's being preached about this ark and there's going to be rain coming? They're laughing, ha ha ha, what are you doing with a boat in the middle of dry land? There ain't no water around here, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. When the rain started coming, they all started running up, and God had shut the door. You don't know it didn't shut the door. But you know, in a firing squad, they used to idea. So anyway. So the Bible says that there were eight souls and creatures of every sort. So there's all these different things in there, but the common denominator was what? They're all in. Okay? So, you know, you might walk over and go, oh, it's a panda. The only value any of them have is they're in. Within God's eyes, he's not seeing all of them in there. He's just seeing the ark. He's not saving all of them. He's saving the ark and those that are in. You know that? He's not going. I mean, you say, you know, so I have to try to cover all the bases. I can't think the way everybody thinks. So if somebody's thinking, oh, you're saying In the context that we are saying and we're using right now, that is not an issue to be brought up. Because we have no scriptural proof that God is looking on the inside and going, oh, there goes the koala. Or whatever. He's not that I'm going to give you the way out. Whosoever will that gets in is out. You know, out of those judgments. That's it. You see that? I mean, it's just that simple. I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to show you from my heart what I got planned. Now, do you want to be in or not? And if you say yes, then whatever happens to the ark, if it gets raised up on the water, if there's a resurrection of it, everybody in it gets raised too. It's all New Testament reality. It's all, and any faith that anybody came to, whether it's Old Testament times or New Testament times, is based on this kind of spiritual principle. You can't have faith in just there's a merciful God. I mean, folks, you know, million religions that believe there's a merciful God, especially if you do what he wants. He's real merciful, as long as you do what he wants. And God is looking on this whole scene. Creatures of every sort. Seeing his son. He's not seeing what kind of creature you are. And just news for you, if you happen to be a fuzzy koala, he's not seeing the octopus that you're eyeballing over. You understand what I'm saying? He's not seeing, he doesn't look on the outward appearance. He is looking at this reality of Christ, and he's saying, you have grace and you have mercy because you're in my son. You're covered. Everything comes with him. Because you're in him. So, you begin to realize then that all of them are dead and buried and resurrected, but only by were, we'll explain this as we go, is not going to come on those who are in Christ. The judgment falls on him. He goes through the judgment. He's the only one who makes it through the judgment, comes out into the new creation. And those that are in him. But those that are in him are one with him. They're not of wars. There ain't any rumors anymore. You get it instantly on the net. Television, right? Or the internet beats the rumors to us. You know, here goes the rumor and then the internet. I mean, there's just, you get all the madness at once of what's going on. And so we go, oh, if those people were alive at the beginning of World War II, they would have surely believed that Hitler was the Antichrist. And his little band of people that were joining with him was the seven-headed dragon, or ten-headed dragon. And then, all of this, this is it. This is, and there's war, and the whole world's gone to war, and everybody's getting killed, and there's destruction and madness, and they're killing off Jews. It. My God, what kind of world do we live in? Well, a bad one. So, okay, then I'm going to change my focus. I'm going to heaven. I'm going to heaven. Yep, yep, yep. I'm going to go to heaven. I'm going to get me a good mansion. I'm going to get me a big mansion. Yes, sir. And they're all excited about streets of gold. You know why? Because they're made of gold. They're interested in gold. Folks, if you let some of these people in heaven, they will be pulling the pearl out of the pearly gates. Selling it or trying. Digging up the streets of gold. Look at this brick I got here. Well, I got a bigger one than that. I got the steps to the throne. Jesus. What about the fact that heaven and earth will pass away and only that which is Christ, and he swallows up all of that, and then in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he gathers up all things in heaven and earth in him, I say, in him. He goes on to say that and emphasizes that the last eternal bastion is not heaven. Does that give anybody a reason to stop focusing on all that foolishness? Well, it's a good reason, but will we? No, not until our hearts turn to the Lord. When the heart turns to the Lord, then, have you ever seen those lizards with their eyes kind of rotate and look back over here and stuff like that? God didn't make you that way. Even though you got two eyes, much can only focus either bore the judgment. You didn't feel one stripe. You didn't feel one slap that he took. He did. But he did. He did. He did go through our judgment. He suffered in place of us. He who knew no sin was made to be sin that we might be made the righteousness of God in 1 Corinthians 5:21. So he became the vehicle. That's just so important. Let me use another term that maybe we haven't applied to Jesus like we should have. He became the vessel. Because we always think of Christ enough, amen? Well, interestingly enough, he came as a vessel. First, he came as a vessel when Jesus walked the earth as the vessel of the Father. The words I do, not my own. That's what he said. The words I speak, they're not my own. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I'm a vessel. I'm a vehicle of God. He came as the express image of God to express the image. He also came that he might be the vessel in the weak world to, number one, go to the judgment, experience the judgment in him, and he goes through the death as the rain falls, he goes through the burial as the water dries, and he goes through the resurrection as the ark rises. And we experience, and that's part of what I want to get into later, but we experience things, but not like the judgment of those who are outside the ark, but it is still the same judgment. It just has a different angle to it. And so, let's see, he goes through the storm and is battered. Jesus became a wooden ark, a vessel. Through this vessel, we're brought into newness. We cannot make this journey without him. We cannot make this journey without him. And I don't care how strong you are, and I don't care how weak you are. It doesn't matter. Your strength will not be enough to go through the waters that you have to go through. And I got news for you. Person in this room or the weakest person in Texas. We know there are no weak people in Texas. Just kidding. If you're the weakest person in the world, it doesn't matter. The journey is made by Christ and you being in him and you believing in him and you holding on to him and abiding. Abide, abide. Don't let go. Don't let go. Abide. Hold on. Everything will try to shake you from him. Put the focus back on you. You, you, you. Or if we all said that together, we would say, you, you, and all say, I. There is no I in team. There is no I in cross or death or resurrection. Or, you know, there's no I in a lot of stuff. Bacon either, but that's sort of off the, you know, but I mean, but in truth, you know, there is no I in team. Oh, I got news for you. There is no I in death. There is no I in resurrection. There's only we, the one. Who's the one? Jesus. Who's his body made of? We. We, the one. We, the one. We hold on to that because why? Why? Why would we hold on to that? Why would that be such an incredible thing if we just fight for it? Because Noah looked into the heart of God. I'm telling you, I cannot tell you when he made it past the eye. that's just not not what a survivalist does. A survivalist does what they do in preparation to save themselves, really pretty much against everyone else, so that we can be saved. In other words, you're not pointing at God or the devil, you're pointing at anybody else who's trying to take your food, or your thing, your batteries. And I've read so many times throughout, you know, the scriptures where it talks about justice. It says your gold and your silver won't help you. You know, you go to the caves and you'll cry, you know, mountains fall on me. Place. I mean, you could freak out when you read all that. Could you not? Could you not just freak out and go, oh my God, it's just all horrible. Well, there's a haven. His name's Jesus, and he's more than the guy you go to. Okay, so if all you see is grace in the eyes of the Lord, then here's what you're going to do. Oh, the judgment's coming, so Lord, you know, I'm going to go up here in the mountains and get in the cave, and I hope that you will make fresh water up there. Through this vessel, we are brought into newness. We cannot make this journey without him. I don't want to leave that until I have a period at the end of the sentence, and that is, there is no way anybody outside of that ark was going to make it. Only those that were in, they're saying, we're on a journey, and we don't even know where we're going for sure. Remember, he said that of by faith, Abraham went out not knowing. Oh, wait a minute. I thought we're supposed to know everything. Everything's supposed to be bright and clear. Everything's supposed to make sense. We're supposed to have it together. I know where I'm going. I don't know where I'm going, but I know whom I have believed. But I don't know where he's going to take me. Just not showing the truth of end, but showing the truth of not knowing everything. You know, two kids are with their fair. One, the daddy of one of the kids is taking them around and all this kind of stuff. The one kid that doesn't have his daddy there, but who's just come along with the other kid, says, my daddy gave me $20 to ride whatever I want. The other kid said, well, I don't have $20, but I got daddy. The other kid didn't have daddy, but he had $20. Quickly, for some reason I'm jumping subjects now because of the time of the end. But have you ever wondered how $20, like if you were a teenager and somebody said, put $20 in the office. You don't even have to be a teenager for this. You go, oh my God, that's so much, you know. But if you're getting ready to go to the mall and you asked your parents for money and they gave you 20, you go, only 20? I mean, you see what I mean? It's just all relative to you know, how we think. Well, it's so much here and so little over here. It's so much when I give it. It's so little when I, when it's about me. All right, so without him, we remain in the old, in the judgment. Romans 6, we see that we went through the cross, through the blood, with him. Bore the brunt of the storm outwardly. He is our shield and our fortress. All right, I only got two more sentences after this, but let me say that. Do you know what it means for him to truly be your shield and your fortress?
safe.
Sliding in, whoa,
safe.
The righteous run into him and are, I barely made it in. I'm safe because I'm in him, not because he fixed everything. You say, will I make it? Will he make it? And in truth, has he made it? And have you already made it with him? That's why we focus constantly. How about this? That's why we constantly turn our focus back to him. That's why. Good to hear it again. Is it not good to refresh our souls and to quicken our spirits and to cause faith to rise again and to get us stirred up to move in the direction of the Lord and away from the problems and the situations of life? If he holds up, we hold up. Our confidence is in him and not in excited to know Jesus, because in knowing him, I'm not becoming better. I'm not, you know, in so many ways, it just seems like I'm not as strong as I used to be. I'm not as, you know, it's really like I'm not as confident as I used to be. Well, I always was a confident guy. I mean, I was. Well, you talk about everybody else, you know, I used to quote from Cassidy in the Sundance too. I got vision and everybody else is wearing bifocals. But as I've gone on, I find that the only confidence I really have is in the art. It's like I had confidence in this house I built. I'm thinking of knowing that. Got confidence in the house I built. Well, confidence in the cattle I have, well, I got confidence in the, it's all just washing away. It's as if we're already in the flood, and he's already washing away all the things that used to give us confidence, and that used to, things of the flesh that made us confident, and he's putting us in a position where, you know, just say, all I've got's Jesus. You ever heard somebody say, you know, a rich man, and, you know, he died, and he said, well, he can't take it with him. You know, can't take it with you. Well, folks, whatever you had confidence in, you can't take it with you. So you just are extremely weak, but you are resting in the strength of the Lord. And that's all you got. Wasn't for him, what would you have? Yourself? You can't run away from yourself. So what would you have? You would have you. And I will say this, many of the problems that we go through because we are after the Lord, not because we're selfish. All right, let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much for the ark. Thank you that what is in your heart was to provide a way, but that way is union with Christ. It's not by getting better or stronger or more spiritual or figuring everything out prophetically or anything. It is just to build him into our lives and then get in. So, Father, we just trust you to weave the realities of this into our being, whether we understand everything or not, going out not knowing, or like Noah in an ark, not knowing where it's going fully, just going with you, just being with you, Father. You're enough. We don't need to know how much you got in your pocket. We got you. And we rest in you and we love you. And we want you to know that we love you. And we thank you for your wisdom, which is far above ours. And we thank you for your direction, which is far more merciful than we would ever comprehend in this life. But we believe in you. Even when we squeal and fight, we believe in you. And we trust you to finish the work that's